Hi everybody, this is Kim Aaliyah and welcome to the first in a series of 11 sessions on the history of homeopathy. Even though this is a teaser session, this will actually be the very first session in the overall 11-part series. So before I get started right into the subject matter of the history of homeopathy, just let me talk about a few housekeeping issues. First of all, for people who have signed up for the course, you can go to the Moodle website at whncourses.com, and when you go there, you'll see that there's a number of documents that have been posted. Okay, there's a number of documents that have been posted, you can see you can go ahead and download these documents, and there will be additional documents that will be posted to this area of the website as well. So these will be available for your later viewing. Also, there is, if you want to sign up for the course, you can go to the page on our website, and that'll be at wholehealthnow.com. You go to courses. You can go to current courses, and then you just find the course called The History of Homeopathy, and you can go to the bottom of this page and register for the actual course. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. All right, so The History of Homeopathy, its origin and development. So before I get started, let me just first of all thank a few different people who've been very helpful in the creation of this course. I'd like to first of all thank Maria Ringo, who actually teaches a class on the history of homeopathy at the Ontario College of Homeopathic Medicine, and she was kind enough to lend me her PowerPoints. She created over 480 PowerPoints, and she was very she's very gracious to lend those to me. And I did use some of the images and the information in those to develop these slides. I'd also like to thank George Dimitriadis, who's a very great homeopath who created the Bunninghausen Therapeutic Pocketbook Repertory and English translation of that very important work. And he was very kind enough to lend me some excellent slides on the reliability of Hahnemann's Materia Medica. And you will not see those slides during this first session. They'll be a little bit later on, probably in session two or three, but they're excellent and they really demonstrate the incredible accuracy of Samuel Hahnemann's Materia Medica. I'd also like to thank Franz Vermeulen, because I, before finishing all the slides, sent them to Franz. And within a number of hours, he wrote me back about 13 pages of suggestions and feedback, including things like, on slide 47, that wasn't the correct species of Cinchona officinalis or Cinchona. You need to change that, and the species of rhododendron on this slide should have been this. And anyway, incredible detailed information. So thank you, Franz, for all of that. And I'd like to give a very special thanks to Dr. Will Taylor, who has been, I would say, really almost collaborating with me on this project over the last number of weeks. Will has been, first of all, Will is a total genius, an incredible resource. And our conversations sound something like, well, you know, when Hahnemann moved to Khotan in 1821, was he still, you know, chewing tobacco or not? And when he met Lavoisier, did they actually speak or did they just meet with their eyes? And I mean, you know, incredibly detailed conversation. I could hear my wife in the background using the word geek to describe our conversations. But the dialogue that we've had has allowed me at least to try to bring forth as reliable information as is possible in such a type of presentation. So thank you again to those four individuals, and thank you for your participation in this class. I hope that you'll find it to be as useful as I have found it in the process of preparing it. I think the history of homeopathy is very important because we're all part of a historical process, and to understand where we are in the world today, we have to understand where we came from. So in the 1820s and 1830s, in the United States, the corporate body of American physicians, which at that time was a well-established professional class with a virtual monopoly over the legal practice of medicine, basically lost its privileged position and political power. And this was due to a series of competing and hostile groups of practitioners. And as a consequence, the network of medical societies collapsed, and public opinion basically demanded that anybody who wanted to set up as a healer would be able to do so. And until the end of the century, of the 19th century, the medical practice in the U.S. was essentially a three- or even four-way contest among opposed therapeutic persuasions. So there were basically four principal competing views. The traditional medical doctrine of the time, which was derived from what we'll call the rationalist school, and I'll go into explaining that in a little bit more detail, was referred to as the solidist tradition. And this was a doctrine that refers to all diseases to morbid changes of the solid parts of the body. Basically, it rests on the idea that the solids alone are endowed with vital properties and that they can receive the impression of agents that are tending to produce disease. Now, a full exposition of the origins of homeopathy and its opponents, such as the rational school or the solidist tradition or the Methodist tradition, really fall outside of the scope of this class, but it is absolutely necessary to understand this tradition and its roots, and how the birth of homeopathy really is a reaction to this particular tradition. Now, the solidist tradition was derived from primarily the doctrines of people like Galen. Galen was a 2nd century AD a physician and surgeon, who had a fairly good understanding of anatomy and medicine, principally influenced by the theory of humorism. The theory of humorism is something that Hippocrates used, where you had black bile, yellow bile, phlegm, and blood, each of which would correspond to one of the traditional four temperaments. And his theories basically dominated and influenced Western medical science for more than 1,300 years, extremely, extremely influential. Basically, he did these anatomical reports that were based on the dissection of monkeys and pigs, and they largely remained uncontested until about 1543 or so. Galen's theory of physiology of the circulatory system endured until about 1628, when it was overtaken by William Harvey in his treatise De Motu Cordis, where he established that blood circulates with the heart acting as a pump. And medical students continued to study Galen's writings until well into the 19th century. Now, it's interesting that Galen himself was very interested in this debate between what we call the rationalist and empirical medical sects. And we're going to talk about those in more detail later on. But just so you know, there's these two ideas, rationalist school and empirical school. Now, the rational school of antiquity goes back way back into the history of human civilization, and also its subset known as the methodic school, which we'll talk about as well, was an ancient school of medicine that was found in both in Rome and in Greece. And it essentially arose in reaction to what we call the empiric school. Now, the empirical and the rationalist philosophies are basically two logical and consistent thought structures which are in all respects completely antagonistic to one another. And if you look throughout history, you'll see that the great medical thinkers have always belonged to one or the other of these two traditions. Of course, there are more minor thinkers who are less rigorous in their theorizing, and therefore will have an eclectic combination of the two major traditions. That can happen, but generally speaking, you can see that there's a very well-demarked division throughout the history of medicine. Herman Verhaeve, who was a Dutch botanist and physician of European fame, was in the camp of the rationalist school. He's regarded as the founder of clinical teaching and of the modern academic hospital. One of his main achievements was to demonstrate the relationship between symptoms and lesions. And he was also, by the way, the first person to isolate the chemical urea from urine. He had a model called the hydraulic model, where basically disease was seen as some type of imbalance of internal fluid pressure. And I want you to think about this hydraulic model, because that's one of the principal qualities that you'll see associated with the rational school, that you somehow use some model from some other field to describe the really what we would refer to as undescribable processes, the vitalistic processes that occur in a living organism. Now, Hahnemann's discovery, or even really creation of homeopathy, was in reaction or response to this rationalist or solidist school. And in the introduction to the sixth edition of the Organon, he wrote, 2,000 years were wasted by physicians in endeavoring to discover the invisible internal changes that take place in the organism in diseases, and in searching for their proximate causes and a priori nature, because they imagined that they could not cure before they had attained to this impossible knowledge. In other words, that you have to have some knowledge of the inner workings of the body and make some analogous comparison in the field of hydraulics or mechanics or, you know, some other field to explain how the body was actually working. Continuing, Hahnemann wrote, little as we mortals know of the operations that take place in the interior economy in health, which must be hidden from us as certainly as they are patent to the eye of the all-seeing creator and preserver of his creatures, just as little can we perceive the operations that go on in the interior in disturbed conditions of life, in diseases. In other words, we just simply cannot know what the creator has done, how to understand what is actually happening in the complexity of the human living organism, or the complexity that goes on in any living organism. Now, homeopathy and the empirical school is very much related to some of the therapeutic ideas that are found, for example, in Paracelsus. Paracelsus was at the time never called Paracelsus. He was called Theophrastus Bombastus von Hohenheim. He was a kind of a late Renaissance physician. And many of the ideas in homeopathy do have a relationship to the therapeutic ideas that are found in the writings of Paracelsus. But it's interesting because whereas Hahnemann mentions many notable physicians in his writings who lived before him, you know, he literally alludes to hundreds. He never mentions the name of Paracelsus. It never appears anywhere in any of his writings. And it's pretty much certain that there's no way that he didn't know about Paracelsus. It's, you know, he was such a polymath and he read so much. It's probably likely that he didn't mention Paracelsus because he didn't want to be associated with the doctrine of signatures, which was a concept which Paracelsus very much endorsed and supported, but which Hahnemann was very critical of. Another individual who was in the empirical school was John Baptiste van Helmont, and he was the founder of the iatrochemical school. Man of great intellectual curiosity, he studied philosophy, eventually became disappointed, he turned to law, and then became further disappointed with law, and then decided to study medicine. Another individual in the empirical school was George Ernst Stahl. He was a German chemist, physician, philosopher, a strong supporter of vitalism. Again, vitalism is the idea that there's this unseen, non-material anima that guides the body's physiological functions. So you have this entire empirical school that goes all the way back to ancient Greek and ancient Rome. it's taken from the word experiences. It was created in opposition or was in direct opposition to the rationalist or what sometimes is called the dogmatic school. And this can be traced all the way back to the 3rd century BC. The greatest of all of the empirical thinkers was Samuel Hahnemann, the founder of homeopathy, because he established a system which really took this way of looking at the universe to its fullest conclusion. And there were others, you know, people like Louis Pasteur was in this camp as well, but Hahnemann really codified and systematized this approach to understanding how to practice medicine. So you basically have these two traditions, the empirical tradition and the rationalist tradition. One you can see there on the left is Galen, and you can say that this tradition is a more of a mechanistic, reductionistic tradition. And then on the right you have Hahnemann, who is the fullest expression of the rationalist tradition. And you can see that that approach is a more dynamic or holistic approach. You'll see that between them is the word vis medicatrix naturae, vis medicatrix naturae. And this is the word for the healing power of nature. And these two different approaches look at the vis medicatrix naturae in a very different way. They look at the healing power of nature in a completely from a completely different point of view. Now, the most significant point of opposition between these two traditions was over the source of the physician's knowledge of the organism. The more contemporary expressions of these people like Benjamin Rush and his predecessors, we'll talk about Benjamin Rush in just a little bit, they claimed that the physician started from what was perceived with the eyes and the other senses and then proceeded from there through the use of what we call logic or by analogy with branches of science like hydraulics or mechanics or anatomy or chemistry or physiology to draw conclusions about the invisible processes that are going on inside the organism. In other words, they advocated a physiological and anatomical investigation as a path to the knowledge of disease and the morbid phenomena that will cause these. Hahnemann, on the other hand, he maintained that the only source of a physician's knowledge was sense perception, and that whatever knowledge was not attainable in this way was basically inaccessible to the physician. He basically stated that the body's internal processes were not analogous to anything observed in other branches of science and were not subject to the laws of logic. In other words, they followed their own laws. And he expressed this by calling disease a non-material, spirit-like phenomenon. Also, the rationalist school is a mechanistic, reductionistic school, whereas the empirical school is a dynamic, holistic school. And you can see this when Hahnemann writes in one of his earlier essays, "But cabbage, roast beef, and wheaten cakes contain also plenty of nitrogen, carbon, or hydrogen. Where then do we discover in them those properties which were so liberally allotted to these primary substances?" In other words, you can't explain the effect of a plant by looking at its constituent elements, that there's something that goes, that there's some type of synergy and holism that's much greater than the constituent parts. And you will see that this particular issue will even arise later on in homeopathy itself, specifically when Kent begins to combine remedies together without actually conducting a proving on them and begins to describe or predict what he thinks the symptoms of those remedies will be without actually having conducted an experiment. So really you can see that the violent practice of the allopaths and the mild practice of the homeopaths each reflected a certain attitude towards the vis medicatrix naturae. And with the rationalists or the mechanistic reductionistic approach, there was a certain disdain for the vis medicatrix naturae. You'll see this a little bit later on with the bloodletting and the use of calomel and phlebotomy and venesection, all these approaches which were so violent that they would almost actually kill the patient you know, before there was any possibility of any change in their health. These contemporary people like Rush, Benjamin Rush, and the Solidist, they would oftentimes claim that they would follow the principle, but they claimed that we could do better than nature. And they said that there was only a handful of ways that nature was capable of operating, and that the physician was really superior to that, and that he could go beyond what nature was capable of doing. Hahnemann, in contrast, he claimed that the physician was best off following the path of nature by administering medicines in accordance with the law of similars. So when the primary symptoms of the medicine correspond precisely to those of the disease, the reaction of the organism would produce that disease. And Hahnemann believed that what you could do is that you could remove that by giving a medicine that would produce a similar state. Hahnemann basically was hypothesizing that the disease process is unique, inimitable, and subject to its own laws, and not the laws that are developed by scientists working in other disciplines. In other words, it's a spirit-like and not a material-like process. So there's a great book. One of the great historians of the 20th century in homeopathy is Harris Coulter. There's basically Julian Winston and Harris Coulter from the 20th century. And Harris Coulter wrote this four-volume work called Divided Legacy. And in this particular work, he talks about rediscovering the existence of this conflict in therapeutics, what he calls the empirical and rationalist philosophies. And he says rediscovered because he says that, in fact, physicians were very aware of this conflict up until about the year 1800s, about 1800, and that many of the medical histories that were written before that time actually discuss this conflict, which dates all the way back, as I said earlier, to Roman and Greek times. Somewhere around the mid-19th century, in the mid-1850s, when medicine began to introduce a lot of the newer technologies, this fundamental conflict was largely forgotten, and you don't see it being mentioned any longer. However, this opposition, these two ways of thinking, continued, even though they weren't discussed and there was no cognizance of them. They still existed, and people did assume certain camps. Remember, the empirical and the rationalist philosophies are two completely antagonistic, logical, consistent thought structures, which are completely antagonistic in all respects. The conflict between empiricism and rationalism dominates all discussion of medical issues. In any major controversy, you'll always see one side will reflect the empirical position and the other side will reflect the rationalist position. And this is found on a wide scale. It's found very clearly in the 19th century conflict between homeopathy and allopathy. You even see it within chiropractic and osteopathy and orthomolecular nutrition and other fields as well, and even outside of medicine. The empirical and rationalist approaches are not just exemplified in therapeutic modalities, they're basic thought patterns in the human mind, and therefore they're applicable to all human activities. It's interesting that this conflict between the empirical and the rationalist school, this dualism, was also at work within homeopathy. The empiricist homeopaths were those who adhered to Hahnemann's original and very empirical formulation as described in the Organon. The rationalist school, which actually at the time constituted the majority of homeopaths, and we'll talk about this when we talk about the American Institute of Homeopathy and what happened when Carol Dunham gave his very famous speech in 1870 and then the formation of the IHA as a reaction to that. You'll see that the majority of these people actually rejected Hahnemann's original formulation, and they preferred a doctrine that was much more modeled along the rationalist lines that were prevailing in the allopathic therapeutic mode. This is a fascinating area of the history of homeopathy. So there are particular factors which distinguish these two approaches, one from the other. First is that the empirical approach is vitalistic versus the rationalist approach is mechanistic, and this is an approach to the living organism. Also, the empirical doctrine tends to always individualize the treatment, whereas the rationalist doctrine will invariably view the individual patient as a member of a disease group, a kind of a class or an entity, and they'll veer away from individualization. The empirical physician view the symptoms or the data as possessing ultimate value in and for themselves, and they don't attempt to penetrate beneath the surface and speculate about what's going on inside the patient's body. They simply use the symptoms as the data upon which they're going to base their diagnosis and their treatment. In other words, they mistrust anatomy and physiology as a source of medical knowledge, because from their point of view, anatomy and physiology are general, and because of that, they run counter to the empirical principle of individualization. You know, where certain physiological and pathological processes occur in humans as a class, the person, the patient in front of us, may not represent that particular class of patients. You know, there's no person which is the average. The average is an abstraction. Every patient is different and is unique. And it was always the strong conviction of the this is always the strong conviction of the empirical physicians, and therefore from their point of view, the only reliable information is that is developed about the individual himself. Another important distinction between these two approaches is that from the empirical point of view, the conviction was, and it still is, that the living body, whether it's sick or healthy, is always reacting to whatever stresses impinge upon it from the environment. In other words, it's vitalistic. And that also the mode of reaction is not predetermined. The organism will react in a purposeful way to overcome the stress that's impinging upon it from the outside, and that reactive capacity cannot be determined by the physical structure of the body as it's expressed in its anatomy and physiology. The patient's symptoms have to be regarded as beneficial phenomena, as signs of reaction, literally as signs of an effort by the body to cure itself. And because of that, the symptoms should not be suppressed, but supported, strengthened, promoted, okay? Because they actually represent a curative response. If you look at the rationalist school, you see that the physicians regard the patient's symptoms not as a sign of reaction or as a source of diagnosis, but as data which had to be analyzed. The physician wasn't limiting himself to simply observing the symptoms, but to applying logic to determine their meaning, to know what was happening inside the body that produced these symptoms. Basically, they wanted to determine and define the disease cause inside the body that was producing these effects or these symptoms. So the rationalist physician would reject the idea that the body was a reactive entity. They would deny vitalism. Instead, they would espouse a determinist and reductionistic view of the body, seeing it as a material structure, and that material structure would determine its possible modes of behavior in both sickness and health. Instead of viewing symptoms as a sign of reaction, the rationalist physician basically adopted the opposite view. From their point of view, the symptoms were a sign of a harmful, morbific cause inside the body, and therefore they thought it was perfectly natural for the physician to eliminate or suppress those symptoms. They were totally opposed to the empirical similar remedy idea, and instead they used the concept of the contrary medicine, as we saw in that slide with Galen. The contrary medicine that would nullify the symptoms and supposedly therefore cure the patient. Another distinction was between peculiar expressions versus common expressions, and the rationalist and empirical schools took very different approaches to the meaning and significance of what we call common or peculiar symptoms. The empirical school would stress the peculiar symptoms of the patient as the most significant. Basically, they would say that the fundamental processes in the body would produce certain common symptoms in certain patients, and therefore it was the differences in the disease as manifested by the peculiar symptoms that were significant for treatment. In other words, every sick person presents a variety of different symptoms, and some of those symptoms will resemble the symptoms of other patients who have a similar or have the same type of condition. Those were traditionally called common symptoms. Other symptoms of the individual patient would differ from those of every other patient who had a similar or had the same condition, and these were traditionally called peculiar symptoms. And it's interesting, and if you read Divided Legacy, you'd see that Coulter actually traces this all the way back to the 2nd century AD, and he actually found a physician in the 2nd century AD who wrote, what is seen in all cases is less significant than what is seen in a few cases, and what is seen in a few cases is less significant than what is found in a single case. And so here you can see a perfect expression of this particular point of view dating all the way back, you know, more than almost 1900 years ago. Now, of course, this is the opposite of how the rationalists view the symptoms and how actually scientific medicine today views the symptoms. So the rationalist and the current scientific medical paradigm really are diametrically opposed to this particular perspective. Another distinction is between what we call numerous diseases versus few diseases. And if you think about it, if you're using the empirical approach, it's very difficult to classify diseases into categories, because if the peculiar symptoms of a given patient differ from those of all other patients, the concept of a disease class loses its meaning altogether. You can't have a disease class. Now you can have very many diseases, and maybe as many diseases as you have individuals, because everybody has their own unique expression in their own life force. In contrast to this, you had what I talked about as the methodical Methodist school, which is an extreme development or extreme restriction of rationalism. In the Methodist approach, they would actually only recognize maybe two or three possible diseases. And so, of course, it becomes much easier to treat the patient if you've only got two or three diseases and you've only got two or three or four treatments for those. You give everybody the same purgatives or emetics or bloodletting, or, you know, and so it becomes fairly easy to treat. You have a lot more time to make money, because you can see a lot of patients. You can see a similar thing today in conventional medicine, where, you know, you got some type of infection, and even if it's not a septic infection, even if it's viral, they still give you antibiotics, and they can see in 1 minute and out the door you go. So there is an advantage in terms of financial remuneration when you have fewer diseases. Of course, in homeopathy, it's a much more complex situation, because you actually have to understand the unique totality of characterizing symptoms in any particular case, and that takes a lot more time and a lot more effort. Another distinction in these two approaches is that in the empirical school, the basic approach to treatment is much more natural. It works in conjunction with the vis medicatrix naturae, the healing power of nature, and it's also much more gentle. It's not toxic. Whereas in the rationalist school, the approach tends to be what we call heroic. You use very large quantities, oftentimes in combination with other therapeutic agents, and oftentimes the effect can be quite damaging to the body. You can see this, for example, in the case of the use of chemotherapeutic agents in the treatment of cancer. And certainly we'll see this in great detail when we look at the way that medicine was actually practiced in the early 19th through mid-19th century in the United States and Europe. And then the final distinction here really is that in empiricism, it's really a holistic approach, whereas rationalism is a much more reductionistic approach. And, you know, if you think about it, holism really is a much more scientific approach, because it means looking at the whole system and also giving the patient precisely exactly what they need. To the rationalist school, science means prescribing a medicine which has been developed for a disease class or category. And if you think about it for a second, it's not difficult to realize that the holistic one that's based on the unique makeup of that individual is truly scientific, while the second is not. The therapeutics which give each patient precisely what they need is much preferred over therapeutics which treats each patient only as a member of a class, and therefore it's absolutely much more scientific in its actual approach. Now, here you can see on the slide Vladimir Vernadsky. Vladimir Vernadsky was a Russian biogeochemist, incredible thinker, actually. He lived between 1863 and 1945. And the reason that I inserted this slide here is because his approach and understanding of the realms or phases of nature really kind of helps us to understand the difference between a reductionistic mechanistic approach and a holistic dynamic approach. Vernadsky was the individual who coined the term noosphere, and maybe even biosphere, I don't remember, but he was involved in understanding the relationship between the geosphere, or the abiotic realm, and the biosphere, or the living realm, and the noosphere, which is the realm of human cognition. And he said that one will develop from the other, and will use the elements that preceded it, but there will be laws that exist in the higher realm that cannot be explained or described from the lower realm. In other words, you cannot understand the nature and process of life by looking at chemistry, that there is a process at a higher level of order that exists that cannot be explained through simple biochemistry, that you cannot use a mechanistic, reductionistic point of view and try to understand the biosphere. And the same thing with the noosphere. You can't understand human cognition and the human creativity based on what happens in the geosphere or the biosphere. And so here we can see a very scientific understanding of this distinction that was either embraced or refuted by the empirical and rationalist schools. One individual, Albert von Haller, lived from 1708 to 1777. He was one of the earlier regular allopathic doctors who very much influenced the medicine that was being practiced during Hahnemann's lifetime. He was a Swiss physician, and he very much emphasized the centrality of nerves. He was very much an advocate of bleeding, using mercury, using purgatives, using emetics, combining all these things together, and in the process almost killing the patient. Another individual who also influenced the medicine of Hahnemann's time, was the Scotsman William Cullen. If you remember, Cullen was the person whose Materia Medica Hahnemann was translating, and who that led him to the proving of Syncona officinalis, which led to, at least firstly formalized the idea of the law of similars. He was a Scottish physician, a chemist, an agriculturalist. He was one of the more important professors at the Edinburgh Medical School. And he was also a central figure in the Scottish Enlightenment. He was a very good friend of David Hume, and I won't go on about what I think of David Hume on this call. He was also on very close terms with Adam Smith, and again, I won't describe what I tell you I think about Adam Smith. But anyway, William Cullen, basically, he integrated the ideas of Boerhaave, who we saw a little bit earlier as a proponent of the rationalist school, and also another physician by the name of Hoffman, and also Haller. And he basically felt that all pathology originated in disordered action of the nervous system, and that you had to understand the nervous system to understand how to treat disease, that you had to correct those particular imbalances. Now, he was a very well-loved teacher, and he had a great influence. Many of the big teachers in the United States, like Benjamin Rush, were very much influenced by him. John Morgan was influenced by him, William Withering, So he was very, very important. And he, his foremost weapon, and I think that word is appropriate here, his foremost weapon in the physician's armamentarium was what's called the calomel, which is essentially mercury chloride, mercurous chloride. And it's a preparation that had been known long before the 18th century, but it was very much popularized by one of Cullen's writings called The Practice of Physic. And it became a mainstay during this period of time. He also very much influenced John Brown, who developed his own medical system called Brunonianism, which had a big influence during the early 19th century. John Brown was a student of Cullen's, and again, he felt that diseases were caused by excesses or deficiencies of the nervous system, something called nervous excitability, and therefore he advocated bloodletting, emetics, cathartics. If there was too much excitation of the nervous system, he would recommend things like opium, alcohol, and other types of stimulants. And then the most important figure in the United States, which I mentioned to you just a moment ago, was Benjamin Rush. And Rush's system is basically a mixture of that of Cullen and Brown's, with some of his own modifications, of course. And he hypothesized this idea of the principle of excitability and debility. Basically, that there was if there was debility in the system would be defenseless, and this would eventually lead to excitability, and they would be prone to all kinds of different stimuli. And then he had this whole very kind of convoluted kind of understanding of how all these things related to each other. Basically, he felt that the physician was superior to the vis medicatrix naturae. And so he, as a consequence, advocated heroic quantities of medicines, especially calomel. Remember, calomel is that mercurous chloride salt. And he actually he compared the vis medicatrix naturae to a squalling cat, and that gives you an idea of how much contempt he had for the patient's own life healing power, his own recuperative forces. He was also very much advocated phlebotomy or venesection, you know, cutting and bloodletting. It's an old technique. It's, you know, it goes all the way back into Western medicine, but the American practitioners in the early 19th centuries, they carried it to unbelievable lengths, way beyond what their European contemporaries were willing to do. And you can probably credit Rush with this. He had this whole doctrine of something called irregular arterial action, and therefore the patient could always benefit from the loss of blood. And there's even one famous passage where he wrote something like, the bleeding should be continued while the symptoms continue until 4/5 of the blood in the body are drawn away. Imagine, 4/5 of the blood are drawn away. He also used Brown's theory to the max, and you can imagine that all of this stimulated a rise in alternative systems that were opposed to these incredibly harsh therapeutics, because you know, this type of medicine was literally killing people. And actually, it's interesting, when a lot of Europeans would come over, they would travel to the United States, they would comment on what the American population looked like as a consequence, as a result of these heroic practices involving huge amounts of very powerful medicines, and also in conjunction with bloodletting. Bloodletting was, you know, it was the mainstay of allopathic medicine well into the 1840s, 1850s. And in addition to the Lancet, there was a lot of importation of leeches. There's some statistics that in 1839 in New York, that they were, you know, importing like 300,000 annually, and other competitors were bringing in 500,000 annually. So just unbelievable amount of bloodletting, both through the Lancet and through leeches. There was, I love this, there was a certain William Cobbett in Philadelphia who called Rush's therapeutics one of those great discoveries which are made from time to time for the depopulation of the earth. And there was a very prominent Boston physician, Elisha Bartlett, who in 1826 wrote, in the whole vast compass of medical literature, there cannot be found an equal number of pages containing a greater amount and variety of utter nonsense and unqualified absurdity. So This was the state of medicine in the United States in the early 19th century. These ideas basically formed the body of the medically educated and licensed practitioners, and they were called the orthodox or regular or later on allopathic physicians. And as I said earlier, the European traveler to the United States would comment on how few of the Americans actually looked like they were healthy. There was really a big problem with the quality of health in the United States at that time. Now, so this is the first approach, one of the competing approaches that existed in the early 1820s and 1830s in the United States. A second doctrine was that of what were called the Indian doctors, and these were practitioners who had never seen a medical school and very much opposed the therapeutics of the regulars or the orthodox physicians. They would obtain their medical knowledge mostly from the American Indians, the Native Americans, and also from Western Europeans who had themselves been in contact with Indian medicine men. They were also known as herb doctors, and the few educated physicians who became Indian doctors were usually, they were called botanical practitioners, or sometimes they were called botanics. So this is the second group. You had the first grouping, which was the solidist tradition, which came out of the rationalist school, using these heroic medicines, and then the second doctrine was that of the Indian doctors. The third was the Thompsonians, and this was a type of medical practice that was devised by Samuel Thompson and his followers. And again, they turned away from school medicine, and they created a kind of simplified system, which involved very large amounts, copious use of steam baths, and a Native American emetic plant called lobelia root. Sometimes you may have heard of it called referred to as Indian tobacco. And this was quite popular also during the early 19th century. In the 1840s, the Thompsonians and the botanics actually fused. This is in the early 1840s, mid-1840s. They actually fused together, and they formed what was called the Eclectic Medical School. Kent, James Tyler Kent, was a member of the Eclectic Medical School until Richard Phelan, the homeopathic physician, cured his wife. Kent had been unable to cure his own wife using an eclectic medical approach, and Phelan came and cured his wife, and so Kent realized that there was something about homeopathy that was superior to the eclectic medical approach. The fourth system was homeopathy, and of course we know this was the work of the German physician Samuel Hahnemann, 1755 to 1843. The system was introduced into the United States by Hans Birch Graham in 1825. We'll talk about Hans Birch Graham, very interesting individual. And Hahnemann too, as I mentioned earlier, he was motivated by a disgust for the medical practice of his contemporaries, and he had discovered the similia similibus principle and proposed homeopathy as the instrument of a total reform in therapeutics. So of these three forms of sectarian forms of practice which were antagonistic or which were competing with the solidist or rationalist school, homeopathy by far and away represented the greatest threat to the traditional medical ideas and techniques of that time. And the reason for this are two reasons. One, homeopathy possessed and advocated an integrated and extremely coherent doctrinal basis for its therapeutic practices, and also, two, it recruited its practitioners to a large extent from among the ranks of the actual orthodox or regular physicians. And therefore, it really differed from Thompsonianism or from the eclectics by having a very well-developed philosophical basis, and also from the Thompsonianism, because it actually drew many of its adherents from regular educated practitioners. So in the early decades of the century, you had the botanics, you had the Thompsonians, you had the Indian doctors, and they were represented the main thrust of the popular opposition to school medicine. But about after 1845, this role was totally overtaken by homeopathy. Homeopathy pretty much became the hegemonic approach. And by 1862, Homeopaths controlled 110 homeopathy hospitals, over 30 nursing homes, 62 orphan asylums and retirement homes, and 16 insane asylums in the United States. It was quite impressive. You know, I remember a number of years ago traveling to Philadelphia and going to the Hahnemann Hospital and going to their library because it was named after Samuel Hahnemann. It's now an allopathic hospital. And I went to their card catalog to see if they had any books in general circulation about homeopathy, and there was not one in single book. So it's amazing to think that this huge hospital, which was once a homeopathic hospital, has now been completely converted to such a degree in allopathic medicine that you don't even have one book representing homeopathy. And who would have thought? You know, I mean, I doubt that Hahnemann would have thought about this because, you know, Hahnemann's whole life was, you know, I mean, yeah, he was a very successful practitioner. He achieved incredible results. We'll look at his cases and how he thought and how he worked and the development of his thinking over a period of time and how his ideas were evolving all the time. But he was also very much persecuted. And he was forced to move from city to city. He could almost never make a living until really his later years. So maybe he never would have even thought that such a great surge of acceptance in his discovery could ever have occurred. Really, until the end of the century, the American medical scene, until the end of the 19th century, it was marked by constant, incessant clashes between homeopaths and allopathic physicians. And the reason for this is that the doctrinal opposition between these two schools cover every aspect of medicine, from the interpretation of symptoms, to the classification of diseases, to the significance of physiology and anatomy for medical practice, to posology, to the place of surgery and therapeutics, to which drugs and medicines to use in any particular kind of disease, and really every aspect of medical practice. So there was very good reason that there would be this depth of bitterness and controversy between these two viewpoints in medicine, because they are essentially, as we saw in the empirical and rationalist views of the universe, they are mutually exclusive, and the complete acceptance of one implies the elimination of the other. So with that kind of discussion or foray into the state of homeopathy and why homeopathy became so popular in the United States in the mid-19th century, I think the first question we have to ask ourselves as we delve into the actual history, starting with Hahnemann's early life, is why is history so important? And I've always really appreciated this quote by George Santayana, who said that those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. And this is very true. If we don't know our history, we will make the same mistakes that were made in the past. If we don't recognize the errors that have occurred in previous civilizations that have led to their downfall, we're very likely to commit those same errors in our time. And this is incredibly true. In the history of homeopathy, there were huge errors that were made at various times, and we'll learn about these and how there were certain practitioners and certain groups of practitioners who studied and practiced in a certain way that achieved much greater success than other groups that were educated in a different manner and understood and practiced homeopathy in a completely different form. So it's very important to understand history, because by understanding it, we can improve our own success in modern day practice. It's also important to understand that history is not simply a listing of dates and names and events. Yes, of course, we will talk about names and dates and events, but it's much more than that. It's the history of ideas and their ongoing development. How does the human mind understand the world? What is the epistemological way that we approach the universe? What is the ontological understanding of things around us, and how do they develop, and what are the different ideas that clash through history, and how do they develop? This is what really makes history exciting. What I'd like to really bring forth in this particular course, is how we can look at the way that homeopaths in our past actually thought. What was their thinking process? How did they actually practice? What did their cases actually look like? And I think if we can do this, we can really understand how history can help us today in not only improving our own success in practice, but helping homeopathy to become the rightly deserved place it deserves to have in contemporary medicine. When we do this, we have to understand this important issue of opinion, authority, and consensus. And there's this great quote by Constantine Herring, who wrote, "Once again, history repeats itself. One states it, another quotes it. In the end, many state it, and in a matter of years, it becomes public opinion. This fearsome power, void of intellect, crushing, inaccessible to all arguments of reason." And it's very important to understand the effect that public opinion has in any period of history. Unfortunately, people are largely swayed by public opinion. They don't develop their own ideas and thoughts. And I think about this famous quote by James Fenimore Cooper, where he says the same thing, that the greatest danger to the United States, and he's writing this in 1838, the greatest danger to the United States is public opinion, because few, he uses the word men, but few people think for themselves. And you can see that Hahnemann is the perfect example of an individual who didn't accept public opinion. He didn't accept the common point of view about how to practice medicine. Yes, for a period of time he did bloodlet. He did use these purgatives and emetics. But he realized at a certain point that this was not the best way to treat his patients. And because he was a principled and moral individual, he broke from public opinion, he broke from consensus and authority, and he forged his own path. So we will be using, in this class, we won't be looking at the common consensus, the public opinion, what the authorities say. We're going to be using what's called a classical approach. We'll be focusing on primary sources. Yes, there will be times that we employ secondary and tertiary sources, but as much as possible, we're going to look at what are the primary sources. We will read from the original writings of Hahnemann, of Herring, of Bunninghausen, of Phineas Parkhurst Wells, and Henry Clay Allen, and Adolf Lippe, and James Tyler Kent, so we can see how did they actually think, how did they actually see the world around them. What did they see as homeopathy's place in that world? How did they actually practice? What were their posology methods? And from this, I think we'll get a much better understanding that is much more reliable and accurate than if we have to rely exclusively on secondary and tertiary sources. We'll also go through the process of re-experiencing the creative process of the original discoverer of an important idea. This is very important to get into the mind of these great thinkers. How did they think, and how did their creativity result in these incredible discoveries? Because if we can get inside of that, we can foster in us our own process of creativity. You know, if you just read about what somebody did as opposed to actually going through that process, it's a completely different thing altogether. And we'll focus on principles rather than data. Yes, there will be a lot of data, but you will be getting the slides and you will be getting the recording, so you can always go back and, you know, refer to that data. But what's more important than the data, because there's always potential for errors in data, but what's more important than that are, what are the underlying principles? What are the ideas that are the foundation that help us to really understand the importance of what this is all about? You see here I put at the bottom Plato, who's the foremost Western thinker for the classical approach. Thucydides, the great Greek dramatist, and the reason, Thucydides wrote the Peloponnesian War, great historian, who wrote it from the vantage point of actually having lived through that particular period of time when Rome and Sparta were actually fighting. And Aeschylus, the great dramatist, who wrote the Orestia trilogy and Prometheus Bound. And the reason I put Aeschylus down here is, you say, well, you know, what does drama or or tragedy have to do with history. Actually, the best writers of tragedy or drama are the greatest historians. People like Shakespeare and Schiller and Aeschylus are the greatest of the historians, because they understood the important underlying ideas. And the details, the facts, the dates, those are not what's important. What's important is the underlying concepts and ideas that evolve over a period of time and form the true history of that particular period. So we'll be coming at this from that point of view. How would a dramatist look at it? How would Schiller look at it? Why did Shakespeare write the history plays? And how did he, when he described Richard III or Henry V, what was he actually trying to convey? What was the important message in those incredible plays? So because the ideas are important, let's look at the ideas of homeopathy. What are they important? We have to understand that a person is the product of their heredity, of their upbringing, and also of their time and their environment. And if we're going to completely understand a man's actions or a woman's actions and their life work, it's really necessary for us to obtain an accurate knowledge of the whole manner of living of that particular time. Okay, we have to grasp the period in which that person lived. And if we really want to understand Hahnemann or any of the other great practitioners' writings on homeopathy, we have to have an understanding of the cultural and philosophical context within which these geniuses operated. If we don't have that, we're not going to understand really what they were all about. So we're going to look at the intellectual influences. We'll look at the cultural zeitgeist. And we'll, of course, be focusing on original sources from homeopathic philosophy, from materia medica, from the development of the repertory. And, of course, we'll look at the original provings. You know, what distinguishes Hahnemann's provings from those of perhaps some of the later provers? You know, how did Haring do his provings, or Hale, or Burt? And how do those compare to the provings that are conducted in the late 20th or even early 21st century? This contrast and comparison will help us to understand the important ideas behind provings. And of course, we'll be focusing quite a bit on clinical cases so we can understand how these people actually thought. Now, when we study homeopathy, we always study homeopathic remedies, and you know, when we're early on in the study of materia medica, we oftentimes will want to learn the keynotes of the remedy. You have to start someplace oftentimes, and or you might want to understand the important ideas of the remedy in our materia medica. And so I think we should try to do the same thing for Hahnemann. What were the keynotes or important ideas of Hahnemann as an individual? What made him different from other people? And I think for me, some of the important keynotes for Hahnemann was, first of all, a constant and indefatigable pursuit of truth. He was always interested in the truth against authority and consensus. Authority and consensus meant very little to Hahnemann, and this is a unique quality. You don't see this quality in very many people, but as we go through his original writings and we read what he had to say, you'll see this again and again and again. Always this demand for truth above everything else. Second, always emphasizing discovered scientific principles, discovering some principle of nature, and then applying that principle of nature as a form of technology to do good in the world. And you can contrast this with all of these unsubstantiated theories that we saw in the rationalist school that would, you know, try to describe the internal workings of the body as a mechanical process, or a process of hydraulics, or a process of, you know, anatomy or physiology. Hahnemann was not interested in that approach. He was interested in discovering a principle of nature and applying that principle as a form of technology to improve the quality of humankind. Also, Hahnemann was a Christian humanist. Many people don't really know what that means, and we'll talk about that in a little bit more detail later, but he really was, and you can see this over and over again in his writings. He was a Christian humanist. He believed in the goodness of God, and that we were put on this earth to do God's work. that we didn't live in a deterministic universe where everything is set and we can't really have an effect. You know, God, it's all under God's control and we can't do anything about it. No, he believed that we were the agents of God and it was our purpose to do good in the world. And you can contrast this with atheistic nihilism, which really fits into the rationalist approach where you deny the value of the vis medicatrix naturae, the power, the healing power of nature, the healing power of God. Hahnemann believed that homeopathy was given by God, and that man was created in God's image to discover this great truth and to apply it to do good. And he was a deist, and we'll talk about that a little bit more later on as well. Again, he believed that God was acting in the world. And this is in contrast to occultism and mysticism. He was not an occultist. He was not a mysticist. And this is unfortunately a myth which pervades even today our community in homeopathy, where we believe that, you know, his thinking was associated with alchemy and mysticism and the occult. This is not the case at all, and we'll see that in detail when we go through it. And also, Hahnemann had steadfast integrity. Remember, he was willing to literally allow his family to almost starve to death, and actually one of his children was actually killed when a carriage was turned over. He never compromised. Okay, I won't say he never compromised. There were times where he perhaps compromised for short periods, but ultimately he had incredible integrity, where he was willing to even put his own family's health on the line to do what he thought was right. And finally, an incredible level of fastidiousness, hard work. He worked incredibly hard throughout his whole life. Even right after his first wife died, he continued to work and published, you know, those four pamphlets on the cholera epidemic. So, and you contrast this with laziness, and you can see he was an incredibly hard worker. And if you take all these and you put them together, you can see that in combination with the incredible genius that he was, that these are the types of qualities that could allow for something like the creation of homeopathy, because there's never been in the history of medicine any other person who has created by themselves a whole, complete, contained system of therapeutics. Only Hahnemann has done this. In every other system of medicine, it's been contributions by many people over long periods of time. But Hahnemann, by himself, created homeopathy. And that's not to say that homeopathy can't develop and evolve. It can. But it certainly must develop along the same epistemological lines that were laid down by Hahnemann, the same scientific approach that we see in his very earliest writings all the way up until 1843 in the sixth edition of the Organon. So unique qualities, and again, something you will not see very commonly in many people. Hahnemann was a very, very unique individual amongst one of the greatest human beings who's ever lived on this planet. Now, Constantine Hering, in his inauguration speech, wrote about these medical writings, and he was very clear that Hahnemann was absolutely not a mystic, and that even in religious matters, he was not a mystic, and that this is really a fabrication that has persisted to the present day, that his thinking cannot be found in the Hermetic traditions, the occult, the alchemy, or magic. In an essay which was published in Grislick's Hygieia from the year 1847, which was entitled The Essentials for Judging Hahnemann Correctly, Hering wrote, in order to be able to form an opinion concerning this man who belongs to history, it's necessary to describe in clear and firm outlines the period in which Hahnemann was born, his life in Meissen, his father and mother, the school years, as well as the early education of the boy. He said it would then be necessary to describe his life and activities up until the year 1790, the year that he proved or ingested Syncona officinalis. And discovered the principle, or at least formalized the principle of healing. Hering writes, it will be necessary throughout not to pass judgment or to give a mosaic piece together of pros and cons, which would only satisfy the superficial reader. Causes must be given in their original form. In other words, we have to go to those primary sources. We have to use a classical approach to really understand Hahnemann or any of the other great practitioners that will be described in this course. Progress and growth must be demonstrated without any reference to possible errors. Again, using a classical approach with primary sources. The first essential is to represent the moral man, his emotions and sensations. And you might be thinking, well, why does that matter? I mean, he's a scientist, he's a doctor. You cannot divorce the morality and integrity of a physician or a healer or a scientist from his accomplishments, because if you do so, then you cannot possibly believe that that man would always act to the benefit of humanity. A perfect example of this is Buckminster Fuller. Buckminster Fuller, whose daughter died at a very early age and who went bankrupt in his business, reached a point of crisis in his early life and had this type of epiphany experience where he realized that everything that he did from then on would only be for the benefit of all humanity. And as a consequence of that, he made great discoveries and was never compromised in what he was willing to do. He never compromised himself to authority or consensus because he was this moral man. And we have to see this in the actual personal life of the scientist or healer. Herring goes on to say, as depicted in his writings and in the many published and unpublished letters, and to use other information and testimony. Herring goes on to write that after that, his character, his mode of thinking, again, not the dates and events, but how did he actually think, his ideas in connection with his home life, his life as a citizen and in politics, his action as a man, husband, father, and citizen must be delineated. Then let us describe him as the physician, teacher, colleague, and debater. Now, there's another book when you're looking at the history of homeopathy that's very useful. It's the Theory and Practice of Homeopathy by Robert Dudgeon. Dudgeon was very important as both a practitioner and teacher in the early days of homeopathy in England, and he was a translator of many of Hahnemann's works into English. He was based in London and was, along with Dr. Quinn, one of the most important homeopaths during homeopathy during that early period. This book is a fantastic book. It's I actually prefer to Kent's lectures because it doesn't have a lot of that Swedenborgian kind of biblical commentary aspect to it that you find in Kent's lectures. It seems much more modern, and also it's historically contextualized. I mean, it's 565 pages, which cover almost every aspect of history, of homeopathy, its development. It's kind of dry, and it only is up until 1853, so it doesn't have the benefit of knowing about the sixth edition of the Organon, but it really does encompass everything up into the fifth edition. And it's packed with information you won't find anywhere else. It gives very detailed accounts of the views of nearly all the homeopathic doctors throughout the world. You have to take it with a grain of salt because he is dismissive of people like Constantine Herring, of Johann Ernst Staff, of Gustav Wilhelm Gross, because they were high-potency practitioners, but basically really, really good information. And it's backed up with incredible historical detail and also based on his own clinical experience. You got to be a little bit careful because he was very much associated with Hughes, so he's a real advocate of being a low potency prescriber. I mean, he was against high potencies just on principle. In other words, popular opinion, consensus. He was never used anything above 6x, and mostly used 3x's. And you can be sure that he would have been very much against some of the writings that you find later in Hahnemann because they were. Really just went against his way of seeing the world. But very, very useful information and very well worth reading if you really want to understand the history of homeopathy. Another very important work is called The Life and Letters of Hahnemann by Thomas Lindsley Bradford. I love Bradford. He's an excellent writer. He has a kind of prosaic, very lyrical style of writing. And he was the guy who kept alive a lot of the history records in Philadelphia. William Harvey King did it in New York, but Bradford did it in Philadelphia. And he graduated from Harvard Medical School. He went to the Homeopathic Medical College of Pennsylvania. We'll talk about that school. It's very important in the history of American homeopathy. He was on the faculty of the Hahnemann Medical College, and he actually became the curator of the college library. And while he was there as a curator, he actually had this collection called the Scrapbook, Bradford's Scrapbook book, which was basically 35 volumes that were alphabetically arranged, that were filled with letters and photos and all kinds of things that related to homeopathy. He's also the author of some very important books, like the Homeopathic Bibliography of the United States, the History of the Hahnemann Medical College, which is very, very important, an index to homeopathic provings, the Logic of Figures, which we'll talk about a little bit later on, very, very interesting book, and the Pioneers of Homeopathy. So very important early historian. He was also the professor and librarian at the Hahnemann Medical College, and in his biography he wrote in the Life and Letters of Hahnemann, which is one of the works that I used for the creation of this course, he wrote, "This compilation has been made so that not only the younger physicians and students of our school, but other readers may readily gain access to the details of the life of Hahnemann, the brilliant chemist, the learned physician, the great reformer, and the cultured man, and that they may become familiar with the story of his marvelous career." So you can tell, a very lovely way of writing. The problem with Bradford is that he was an American, and he never left the United States for any length of time, and he knew very little about German conditions, and he never was able to master the German language, and therefore he could never use the original sources for the compilation of his work. And in addition, the German archives were basically not accessible to him. He did make several attempts to obtain the information from the German government authorities, but he was never able to succeed, and probably because he made his requests in English. And then eventually he got discouraged, and so he gave it up. And so basically his work does have errors because he doesn't have access to these original primary German sources. Another wonderful book, A History of Homeopathy by Wilhelm Amicke. Amicke was the son of a doctor. He studied medicine in Germany in 1865. And in 1872, he wrote to a friend of his, he said, I already have an extensive practice, but practice as an allopathic doctor I do not like. Often I am ashamed to prescribe a medicine which I know from the outset is completely useless. And his friend was a homeopath, so he said, what do you do with homeopathy? Because your father is also a homeopath. I would like to investigate the method. And I guess it took a while for his friend to respond, so he didn't even wait, and he went and he found, he moved to Köthen, where Hahnemann lived between 1821 and 1834, and he went to the clinic of Arthur Lütze, who we'll also talk about in more detail, and he went there and he began to study and practice homeopathy, and he spent a number of months with his friend in Berlin, where he studied homeopathy, and then he wrote this book called The History of Homeopathy, and he was a very ardent advocate of homeopathy. And this book is excellent because it looks at a lot of the primary writings of what Hahnemann said and what other people said during that particular period of time. So it's an excellent source of information, and if you're really wanting to delve in to an understanding of the history of homeopathy at a very deep level, this is an invaluable book. I will warn you, it's amazingly dry, and a couple of pages of this is an excellent cure for insomnia. Then we have Richard Hale, who wrote this two-volume a work called Samuel Hahnemann, His Life and Work, and I use this book extensively for the creation of this course. Hale was a very careful researcher. He researched all the German homeopathic literature. He sifted through all the material he had at his disposal. He literally searched hundreds of volumes of periodicals, books, going way back into the early beginnings of homeopathy, even Hahnemann's youth, essays, letters, almost anything you could think of in German and English. In his Life and Works, he wrote, "All investigations could not be made from my study. I therefore undertook several journeys from which I returned home with a rich store of valuable material. In the year 1900, I visited the son-in-law of Hahnemann's second wife, Dr. Karl von Bunninghausen of Darup in Westphalia, in order to negotiate with him about Hahnemann's literary heritage and to acquire at the same time a more intimate information regarding Hahnemann's life in Paris." Now, just so you know, Karl von Bunninghausen was actually married to Hahnemann's stepdaughter, Melanie Hahnemann's adopted daughter, and therefore inherited from Melanie Hahnemann the entire heritage of Hahnemann's literary writings. Melanie Hahnemann had died before he visited in 1899, and so then he went there and he tried to get these original writings, but he was unsuccessful, and eventually von Bunninghausen provided all of these works for him, and he traveled from Stuttgart through the Ruhr Valley, even through these revolutionary outbreaks that were going on at the time, and brought back this incredible scientific legacy of Hahnemann, his case books, his symptom index, his original provings of medicines. Many of his letters were in his possession, and he literally sifted through all his materials, and it was just an incredible legacy that contained an overwhelming amount of valuable material, which in many cases shed completely new light, especially on the period in Cöthen between 1821 and 1834, and then the last years of Hahnemann's life between 1834 and 1843. So he was an Orthodox physician. He was also the editor and publisher of this journal called the Admacene. And he was also the individual who retrieved the sixth edition of the Organon. Remember, the sixth edition of the Organon was published, was written in 1843, just before Hahnemann died, but was not actually published until 1921. So almost 80 years went by before Hahnemann's final word on homeopathy was actually revealed to the majority of homeopaths. Most homeopaths who practiced in the 19th century and early 20th century knew nothing about the quote-unquote LM or Q potencies, or about many of the other differences between the 5th and 6th editions of the Organon. And we'll talk about that in more detail later, what those differences were, especially as it relates to posology. Hale wrote in his Life and Works, "In desperation, I had almost given up hope, when at last, in 1920, with Dr. Borecki's help, I succeeded in obtaining the complete legacy of the master. After having been held back for almost 80 years, it was at last to become accessible. The longing of 3 to 4 generations of physicians was at last to be gratified." And you can feel in this his incredible excitement, not just for himself, but what he was bringing to the whole homeopathic community, and how people were so wedded to the idea of really understanding how Hahnemann actually practiced and learning from the great master, and that finally, after almost 80 years, this finally became available to them. There's also a wonderful History of Homeopathy book called The History of Homeopathy in America by William Harvey King. Excellent book. If you're really interested in the history of homeopathy in the United States, this would be the book to get. King basically graduated from the New York Homeopathic College in 1882, and this four-volume set was published in 1905, and it remains basically a landmark work on the subject. And also we have a more contemporary homeopath, unfortunately passed away recently in New Zealand, Julian Winston. Julian was a good friend, and later on in the course I'll share you an amazing story about Julian Winston. And he wrote this wonderful book called The Faces of Homeopathy, which is very rich in terms of its photographs and wonderful little vignettes and stories about the various personages, men and women, who were involved in homeopathy throughout its history. Lovely work, and really well worth reading. So when we study Hahnemann, you know, we read things like, you know, Hahnemann was the founder of homeopathy, and he's the guy who stated that that which can produce a set of symptoms in a healthy individual can treat a sick individual who's manifesting a similar set of symptoms, and this principle, similia similibus, became the basis of an approach to medicine to which he gave the name homeopathy. We read things like this, or we read that we read about the aphorism 3 of the Organon, you know, which is essentially the blueprint of the Organon. And the reason, by the way, that this is important, I won't read it now, we'll go back and read it later, is because if you read this, you can see that Hahnemann really was firmly in the camp of the empirical school. That what had to be realized was what you could see in the disease of the patient. And what needed to be seen in the medicine was what you could discover through doing approving. And then when you observe those two things based on your experience, you would combine them together, and through the principle of the law of similars, and then you would cure the patient. And then the last thing he says in here is that you can, you must, to be a true physician, you have to remove the obstacles to cure. In other words, not only do you have to apply this similia similibus principle, but in addition, you must practice hygiene. You must practice nutrition and hydrotherapy and having a good mindset, so that all those things come in combination together to bring a patient towards a state of health. Hahnemann was called the father of experimental pharmacology, and he was really the first physician to prepare medicines in a very specialized way, and I put this word in quotes here, prove, because it comes from the German word prüfung, which means to experiment or test these various medicinal substances on a healthy person. And before him, medicines were not given in this way. They were given on speculation, on this theoretical construct, and on the basis of authority without this experimental verification. And then you can go on, you can say, well, he was born in Meissen in 1755 to a working-class family of porcelain designers, and that, you know, he mastered 6 languages by his early 20s, you know, including German, French, English, Italian, Latin, Greek. He learned Arabic, and he lived for many years, making his life as a translator. He was had huge interest in chemistry, and studied it for quite a bit during his earlier years, and that he was trained as a doctor in Leipzig and Vienna, and graduated from the University of Erlangen, you know, and so you can write all these things and say them. But as I said earlier, and as Herring so aptly wrote, we have to understand that the time and the period that Hahnemann lived if we really want to understand who Hahnemann was. So I'd like to just quickly go through some of the important events and important people who lived during this period of time, so we have a context for Hahnemann as an individual. What was actually going on? Well, one of the things that was going on in his early life, remember he was born in 1755, was the Seven-Year War. It was called the Seven-Year War in Europe. In the United States, it was called the French and Indian War. And this war ran from 1756 through 1763. Hahnemann was born in 1755. And when you have wars, you know, it generally causes a lot of impoverishment. It causes a lot of problems for the people who live where that war is happening. And this was absolutely the case for Hahnemann. It affected the porcelain industry in Meissen. And as a consequence, Hahnemann didn't have, or at least Hahnemann's father didn't feel that he had the financial means to be able to provide Samuel Hahnemann with the education that this incredible prodigy, this gifted young man, so much deserved. So you can see this is an important event that happened in Hahnemann's early life. This was also the time in his early life. Remember, he was born in 1756. That as a young man, he had the Declaration of Independence in 1776. You had the Constitutional Convention in 1789. There was a spirit of that the times were changing, that that the old European system of oligarchy was breaking down, that the American experiment of a nation based on a republic, based on the promotion of the general welfare. This was something that was being discussed throughout the European salons and circles of Hahnemann's young adulthood and young life. So you can imagine that even though Hahnemann rarely spoke about politics, that these ideas had an influence, and that the ideas, these Republican ideas, worked in conjunction with the same type of scientific ideas that Hahnemann was trying to develop in his discovery of homeopathy. It was also, unfortunately, the time of the French Revolution from 1789 to 1799. Yes, the French Revolution started very positively with people like Antoine Lavoisier and the Marquis de Lafayette and Simon Bailly and all of these great Republican leaders, but it degenerated into a complete level of barbarism. And you will see later on that this impacted various periods of Hahnemann's life when he was really in the process of developing homeopathy. And it was also the period of the Napoleonic Wars between 1803 and 1815, and you had the typhoid epidemic of 1813, and these wars are very much related to epidemics because the hygiene level goes down. There's an impoverishment of the wealth of the nations that are involved in these lengthy wars, and this makes the population much more vulnerable and susceptible to epidemics. And we saw this. You saw this in the flu epidemic of 1916. You saw it in the 1913 typhoid epidemic. So he lived through this period of time, and he actually even commented, and we'll see, about the effects of the French Revolution and the Napoleonic War on his own life. And you had the 1815 Congress of Vienna after the Napoleonic War, after Napoleon was defeated, where Prince Metternich came in and created this kind of proto-police fascist state and really suppressed the culture of that period. That 2 years later, in 1817, you had the Carlsbad Decrees, where they basically outlawed all types of Republican ideas, and even the plays and writings of Friedrich Schiller were completely outlawed. They were actually made illegal during this particular period of time. So these events all had an impact and effect on Hahnemann's life. And you had very important people who were contemporaries of Hahnemann, like Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Hahnemann was born in 1755. Mozart was born in 1756. Okay, Mozart only lived to the age of 35. He died in 1791, and Hahnemann lived to 1843. But the early parts of their lives overlapped very closely. And Mozart was an individual who wasn't just a great composer. He was a political figure. You know, he wrote The Marriage of Figaro and The Abduction of the Seraglio and Don Giovanni, and these were political works, and the ideas of Mozart were pervasive in the culture at that time. And even if Hahnemann never wrote about them, you can imagine that this had some effect on the zeitgeist of the period in which Hahnemann was actually living. And you had Antoine Lavoisier, the great chemist, the French nobleman, who basically created a chemical revolution. He's considered largely to be the father of modern chemistry, and tremendous accomplishments. Everything from the discovery of the role of oxygen and combustion, to actually naming oxygen and hydrogen, to the construction of the metric system, to the list of the elements, to chemical nomenclature. Lavoisier was a giant in the field of science. And as I mentioned earlier, it seems that Hahnemann at least was in the same room as Lavoisier. Maybe he spoke to him, maybe he didn't, maybe their eyes met, maybe they didn't, but that's not what's important. What's important is that Hahnemann looked up to Lavoisier. Hahnemann himself was a chemist. He was a great chemist, actually, as we'll see when we look at his translations. And he looked up to Lavoisier as somebody who could be his own mentor. Unfortunately, Lavoisier was a victim of the French Revolution. At the height of the revolution, Jean-Paul Marat actually accused him of adulterating some tobacco, and Lavoisier, unfortunately, was guillotined. But he was a great man. He was a collaborator of Benjamin Franklin. He actually was part of the Benjamin Franklin inquiries into mesmer on animal magnetism. So a great man, and somebody who very much influenced Hahnemann's life. Lavoisier was the individual who disproved what was called the phlogiston theory, and this was the universally accepted theory of the time. It's completely obsolete now. It's basically, it postulated that there's this fire-like element called phlogiston, which was contained in combustible bodies, and that it was released during combustion. It was a theory that basically tried to explain burning processes such as combustion or rusting. All this is now collectively known as oxidation. To be perfectly honest with you, it's one of the most, in my opinion, ridiculous theories you'll ever see. But it was the popular idea of the time. And you had Goethe. Goethe was aware of Hahnemann. If you read in Hale's Life and Works, you'll see many places where Goethe refers to Hahnemann. And he actually wrote or said, Hahnemann, that rare combination of philosophy and learning, whose system must eventually bring about ruin of the ordinary receipt-crowned heads, but is still little accepted and rather shunned than investigated. So you can see that Goethe was somebody that Hahnemann was aware of. Now, it's interesting, Hahnemann himself never mentions Goethe, but Goethe was certainly aware of Hahnemann. Schiller was one of the great thinkers of Germany, and he wrote about Hahnemann. He said, confused by the goodwill and hate of parties, the picture of his character sways in history. We must complete by adding, yet art in your eyes shall now, as in your heart, bring him nearer to you. Schiller was the great playwright of Germany. He's the equivalent in the German language of Shakespeare in the English language. He's the writer of William Tell and the Wallerstein trilogy, the Aesthetical Letters, and many many other writings. Really, in many respects, in some respects, even went beyond Shakespeare, because he went beyond the idea of tragedy into the idea of the sublime. And you can be sure that Hahnemann knew about Schiller and understood Schiller's poetries and plays, and that these must have had some influence upon him. And Gotthold Lessing, who wrote Nathan the Wise, that skilled master of the pure German language, he's one of the few that you'll see actually Hahnemann actually mention. Hahnemann wrote a letter to staff, and he references the polemic writings of a philosophically religious character. Again, not a word is mentioned of Goethe or Schiller or any of the other intellectual giants of the German classical period. Hahnemann really focused on medicine and science, but you can be sure that these individuals must have had an effect on Hahnemann. And Beethoven, who is considered, for those of you who are fans of classical music, to maybe have been the greatest composer of all time. There's a wonderful story from Dana Ullman's The Homeopathic Revolution that somewhere around 1800, Beethoven was actually suffering from tinnitus, noises in the ear, and hearing loss. And, of course, the cause of Beethoven's deafness is unknown. But Dana writes that historians are lucky to have a rich cache of letters to and from Beethoven, as well as his conversation books, and that there are references by Beethoven to homeopathy in this written documentation, and it is well known that his doctor between 1820 and 1826 was Dr. Anton Bronhofer, who was a professor of biology at the University of Vienna. Beethoven's nephew, Karl, described Dr. Bronhofer as actually using homeopathic medicine. In late April 1825, Beethoven was suffering from inflammation of his bowel, and in May he was spitting blood. And several sources acknowledge that the treatment by his doctor allowed him to return to work and finish a quartet in July 1825. This is the string quartet in A minor, opus 132. This is the late string quartets of Beethoven. People who are into classical music consider this to be the pinnacle of Western classical music, these late string quartets, because it's a full fruition of the motive führing principle that was first introduced by Joseph Haydn in 1782. And then Dana continues to write, he says, by August 1825, Beethoven wrote to his associate and early biographer, Anton Schindler, in quotes, "My doctor saved me because I could no longer write music, but now I can write notes which help to relieve me of my troubles." In other words, homeopathy was able to cure Beethoven and allow him to write what is considered to be, by many people, the pinnacle of Western classical music. Dana goes on to write, "Ultimately, Beethoven expressed such appreciation to and for his homeopathic doctor, Dr. Bronhofer, that he actually composed two canons in his honor." So Beethoven, another individual which had an important role during that particular time, created the zeitgeist of that period and was himself influenced by homeopathy because it allowed him to live, to be cured, and to write these great pieces of music. We have to understand that both during Hahnemann's time and also during the time of these early homeopaths, that it was a different time than what we have today. And this affected the way that these people were able to study and practice homeopathy. Many of the homeopaths had received a classical education. This is absent from our culture today. And with a classical education comes real critical thinking. They could discriminate and differentiate in a way that we are not capable of doing today because we are not educated with this classical approach. They were versed in Latin and Greek, and also many of them read and spoke German, so they could read Hahnemann in the original German. Most of the original homeopaths spoke English as a second language, even with a German accent, and there's this lovely little story from Tyler's Drug Pictures, where she writes Old Wesselhoff. We'll talk about Wesselhoff later. Though he had thought he had Lippe at a disadvantage, he said, "Dr. Lippe, I have a woman patient who got this peculiar symptom. She felt as though she were walking around on the ends of the bones of her legs and didn't have any feet, as though the feet were gone. What remedy did I give her?" And Lippe said, "You gave her der Chamomilla, by Gott." So, little German joke there. Also, you had to see that during this time, entertainment consisted of reading or listening to stories. People would come together with their friends and family, and they would read, and they would listen to stories, and it was very different. Here you see a picture by Hermann Faber of a round table, actually, at Herring's home, and there you can see Nair and Herring's wife and other homeopathic practitioners and students. And also, many of the homeopaths during the 1800s had full-time servants, so they didn't have to, you know, prepare dinner or go out grocery shopping or do any of the tasks that we have to do today. And this gave them a lot more time. You know, when you wonder, you know, how did Timothy Field Alden produce this 12-volume Encyclopedia of Pure Materia Medica, or how did Adolf Lippe write these thousands of works about homeopathy, or how did Hahnemann publish this incredible, you know, myriad, plethora of writings and all of his great accomplishments. How is this possible? Well, again, maybe not so much with Hahnemann, but with some of these other people, they had the support that allowed them to do it. And there was no television, no shopping malls or instant messaging. It changed the way they saw the world, and they weren't distracted by these types of things in life. And there were no cars or other forms of modern transportation. Here you can see an old ambulance. There's incredible stories of, you know, some practitioner in Carlisle who wants to go visit Adolf Lippe, and it's a, you know, 30-mile distance, and it takes them all day to get there. You know, for us, provided the traffic's, there's not a time for traffic, you know, it might take us 30 minutes. But this was a whole day's trip to get to another practitioner and discuss your ideas with them. And again, this affected the way that people thought and practiced. Now, medicine in the 18th century, too, was extremely barbaric. You had cupping, bloodletting, purgatives, starvation cures, and all this stuff was what they thought would cure a person. So it was a pretty barbaric time, as we saw earlier when we saw how Benjamin Rush was actually practicing. And incredible amount of use of leeches. It was a huge industry during the 18th century. And if you just look at some of the medical instruments of that time, it's a little disconcerting actually to look at these things and think that this is the type of thing that they're going to be using to try to improve your overall state of health with. So quite a disconcerting situation. Now, let's actually look at Hahnemann, the founder of homeopathy. He was born on April 10th, 1755. His full name was Christian Friedrich Samuel Hahnemann. Arthur Lutze writes, on the 10th of April, 1855, the actual 100th birthday of Samuel Hahnemann was celebrated in Cothen, that's where he lived between 1821 and 1834, by the solemn unveiling of a magnificent statue of the master. Now, it's interesting, in the Hahnemann Monument at Washington, if you go there, you'll see that it's not the 10th of April that's there, it's actually the 11th of April that's been retained as the date of birth, even though Hahnemann writes, I was born on April 10, 1755, in the electorate of Saxony, one of the most beautiful parts of Germany. This may have contributed largely to my veneration of the beauties of nature as I grew up to manhood. And I think this is important that he said this, because it shows you that he was connected to nature. He was moved by nature, and therefore he would embrace the vis medicatrix naturae. He wouldn't embrace this more heroic approach to medicine that would be antagonistic to the healing power of nature. By the way, the reason that it's written April 11th is just because in the records it actually shows April 11th, even though Hahnemann said it was April 10th. In any case, it doesn't matter that much. So Hahnemann was born in Meissen, in one of the most splendid areas of Saxony, in a area that's full of fertile fields with wheat and plantation of grapes. This is actually a photograph on the right here of one of the fields in Meissen. Very, very beautiful, and you can see it there on the map of, it wasn't actually Germany at the time, but just so you have a sense, this is all of the places that he lived is now what we call the modern German state. And this was, Meissen was right on the shores of the great Elbe River, which is one of the major rivers in Central Europe. And actually many of the towns that Hahnemann lived in, because he moved around quite a bit, were located on this river. Meissen, Magdeburg, Dessau, Torgau, Dresden, these were all right on this particular river. The river lies, the city lives right on this river, and in construction style you can see that there's this castle of Albrecht in the background, which gives it a kind of very picturesque and romantic type of look. On the right there you can see the city itself, and it's famous for three things. It's famous for this castle, for what's called the Prince's School in the town, and also for pottery. During Hahnemann's time, you remember his father was a potter, worked in the pottery factories, and also it's continued up until this day. There have been periods where the economy has been depressed, and the pottery has been depressed, but basically this has continued in Meissen. It's well known, and even today you can see they actually make very beautiful pottery in this particular city, the home, the birthplace of Samuel Hahnemann. Actually, there were bad times that came upon Meissen and its porcelain factory. If you remember that Seven-Year War where King Frederick II of Prussia went into Saxony, and he took all the supply of the Meissen porcelain and sold it to this count for some sum of money. And that had a very big impact on Hahnemann's early life because it really impoverished his family, and Hahnemann's father felt that he could not afford to educate his young, very, very brilliant son. So it was in this town, the Elbe, that was so prominent for arts and sciences, where the third child of the artist-painter Christian Gottfried Hahnemann was born on the 10th of April, and that son, his name was Christian Frederick Samuel Hahnemann. Here you can see that the home was later on converted to a restaurant called Restaurant Hahnemann. So this you can see here it is. Oops, sorry. Here you can see the drawing of the original home. And here you can see later on it actually became Restaurant Hahnemann in that home. Okay. Now, we don't have a lot of knowledge about Hahnemann's early life, but he actually did write an autobiography about his early life, so we do have some information. Basically, regarding his boyhood, the sources are very, very rare, but we do have this entirely written record, which was handed down by the director of the seminary in Köthen. Basically, he writes that he was born on April 10, 1755 in the Electorate of Saxony, which is one of the most beautiful parts of Germany, and that this may have contributed to his veneration of the beauties of nature as I grew up to manhood. He continues to write that my father died 4 years ago. Without being deeply versed in science, he was a painter for the porcelain factory of that town and the author of a brief treatise on watercolor painting. He had found for himself the soundest conceptions of that which is good and can be called worthy of man. These ideas he implanted in me. And then, I love this passage, he writes, continues to write, he says, to act and to live without pretense or show, to act and to live without pretense or show, was his most noteworthy precept, which impressed me more by this example than by his words. In his deeds, he differentiated between noble and ignoble to so fine a degree of correctness and practical delicacy of feeling as was highly creditable to him. In this also he was my teacher. His ideas on the first principles of creation, the dignity of mankind, and its lofty destiny seemed consistent in every way with his mode of life. This was the foundation of my moral training. You can see that his father imparted into him one of the keynotes that I described earlier, this sense of incredible integrity, this moral man, this individual who was unwilling to compromise, who always looked for the truth and what was principled first, at the dignity of mankind. And this, you can see, is why he was a deist, because he believed that man was created in the image of God, not that he looked like God, but that he had the creative capacity of the divine or of God, and that he could act to do good on God's behalf. And you can even see this clearly in his writings, for example, in the ninth aphorism of the Organon, when he talks about that in the healthy human state, the spirit-like life force that enlivens the material organism as dynamis governs without restriction and keeps all parts of the organism in admirable, harmonious, vital operation as regards both feelings and functions, so that our indwelling, rational spirit can freely avail itself of this living, healthy instrument for the higher purposes of our existence. You can see this sentiment in his early autobiography coming out in the ninth aphorism of the Order, where he says that the purpose of homeopathy is to help the individual reach the higher purpose or lofty goal of our existence. And you can also see it in his author's preface to Chronic Diseases, where he writes, "If I did not know for what purpose I was put here on earth, to become better myself as far as possible, and to make better everything around me that is within my power to improve, I should have to consider myself as lacking very much in worldly prudence to make known for the common good, even before my death, an art which I alone possess, and which it is within my power to make as profitable as possible by simply keeping it secret." He's referring here to the use of belladonna in the treatment of the scarlet fever epidemic of the late 18th century, and how he would prefer to give it to mankind, to humankind, and have it benefit all of humankind, and then keep it for himself and to profit from him. To reach the lofty goal of human existence from Hahnemann's point of view is to do good in the world, to contribute, to give your life's work, to do something of value that will better everyone around you for this generation and for future generations. This is the way that Hahnemann thought. This is the type of man that he was. And you can see that this comes from the way that his father's example and the effect it had on him. Continuing in his autobiography, Hahnemann writes, "I spent several years in the town of Meissen, and when I was about 16 years of age, I attended the prince's school of that town. The rector of the prince's school, Magister Müller, loved me as if I were his own child. He was my teacher of ancient languages and German composition." So the rector of the school loved him as if he were his own child. So there was something special about Hahnemann, even in this early childhood. He goes on to write, Hahnemann writes, he says, "In my 12th year, he authorized me to impart to others the rudiments of the Greek language." In other words, when he was 12 years old, the rector says, "You teach the other students Greek, because he was such a prodigy that even at 12, he had knew Greek well enough that he could teach the other students. And it shows you the incredible genius of this young man. Hahnemann goes on to say, he says, "He also listened kindly during the private lessons given to his boarders by myself to my critical expositions of the old writers, and he frequently preferred my own opinion to his own." And again, this demonstrates that Hahnemann had read a great deal when he was a young man, and that the rector of the school thought that Hahnemann's own opinions were preferable to his own. So not only was he a brilliant genius, but somehow he had the ability to not antagonize those who should have been antagonized by such a brilliant young man. Hahnemann goes on to continues to write, says, "I was frequently given preference before many other pupils, and yet it is strange to record that all my fellow pupils loved me." So somehow he didn't antagonize those around him. And we'll have to contrast this with his later life, where he was so greatly persecuted, because you can see that the persecution wasn't because of his character so much. There's an argument that he was an irascible fellow, but I will actually argue differently. But it was because he was confronting authority, consensus, popular opinion of that time, and the money that was implied in that consensus. Hahnemann goes on to write, he says, "I made it my duty to grasp what I was reading rather than read too much, to read little but correctly, and to classify in my mind the portion already read before continuing." So Hahnemann was so versed in the Greek language that he could actually teach the other children at that time. And you could see also that he didn't overstudy. He didn't just read and read and read. He made sure that he understood what he was reading. Here you can see a little monument for Hahnemann that's in Meissen, Hahnemannplatz. So continuing in his autobiography, Hahnemann writes, "My father did not wish me to study at all, again because of the financial burden. He repeatedly took me away from the town school for more than a year at a time so that I might pursue some business more suited to his income. And then listen to this. My teachers prevented this by refusing all payment for my schooling during the last 8 years. He was such a genius, and the teachers at the school recognized this in him, that they refused payment. They said, he comes to school for free. Just amazing, really. I'm lost at words, okay? Here you can see that in 1775, he actually enrolls at the University of Leipzig. After he leaves Meissen, he actually goes there. And this is a very important university in Germany. It's one of the oldest universities in the world. People like Goethe, Wagner, Nietzsche, the current Prime Minister of Germany, Angela Merkel, Tycho Brahe, the great astronomer. He wasn't great, but he was the one who provided all the data for Johann Kepler. And 8 Nobel Prize winners were all people who went to this particular university. And here you can see where Leipzig is in modern Germany today. By the way, you might notice that I spell Leipzig sometimes L-E-I-P-S-I-C and sometimes L-E-I-P-Z-I-G. The reason for that is the L-E-I-P-S-I-C is the old English spelling. I use that when I'm trying to show an older slide. I use the L-E-I-P-Z-I-G when I'm showing a more contemporary picture of Leipzig, like you see right here. You can see it's fairly close to Dresden, which is a place where Hahnemann spent some time later in his life. Hahnemann, his biography goes on to write, he says that at Easter in the year 1775, I was given leave to go to Leipzig with 20 thalers for my support, the last money that I received from my father's hand. And he basically made his living by teaching German and French to a wealthy Greek young man. He attended lectures, but he didn't attend them all. He would only attend the ones that he really felt were useful to him. So even at this early point, he was really able to discriminate between what he thought was useful and what he thought was not useful. Here you can see a modern picture of Leipzig, fairly good-sized city in Germany. And here's the monument which has been erected for Hahnemann. And there's an interesting story. When this monument was originally dedicated in 1851, there was a doctor, Professor Lind of Leipzig, who had actually been a personal friend of Hahnemann and of his family, who related a story that on the attempt being made by the apothecaries and several doctors to drive Hahnemann from Leipzig, we'll talk about this in more detail later, there was a Dr. Volkmann, who was the town clerk of Leipzig, who actually wanted to create a protest against this. And so there was an appeal that was signed by Dr. Linder and also 40 other citizens, and actually was sent to Dresden. And this shows that the town council of Leipzig was actually on Hahnemann's side. The result of the protest was that Hahnemann was able to remain in Leipzig until the prince Anhalt Dessau called him to Köthen in 1821. And so we're going to talk about that in more detail a little bit later. In 1777, Hahnemann transfers as a medical student to Vienna, and in his autobiography he writes, the inclination for the practical side of medicine, for which there was no institution in Leipzig, induced me to go to Vienna at my own expense. And this is where he meets this Dr. von Quirin, who again he develops this very deep friendship with. He writes, I had his friendship, I could almost say his love. I was the only one at that time whom he allowed to accompany him to his private patients. He singled me out, loved and taught me as if I had been one of his first in Vienna, or more than that, and all of this without ever being able to expect any remuneration from me at all. Again, the same type of theme of people loving him and recognizing his incredible genius. Afterwards, in 1777, Hahnemann moves to Hermannstadt at the invitation of Samuel von Brückenthal, and this is to help organize his library and coin collection. And again, in Hahnemann's autobiography, he writes, "My last crumbs of subsistence were just about to vanish when the governor of Transylvania, Baron von Brückenthal, invited me on honorable terms to go to Hermannstadt with him and his family physician and the custodian of his important library." Now, this is very important because in his library are many important works that really helped form Hahnemann's understanding of medicine. So this is a very important period in the development of his thinking. Hahnemann goes on to write, he says, "Here I had the opportunity of learning several other necessary languages and of acquiring knowledge of some collateral sciences in which I was still lacking." He goes on to write, "I arranged and cataloged his matchless collection of ancient coins as well as his library, practiced medicine for a year and 9 months in this populous town, and then departed, although very unwillingly, from these honorable people." And he then went to Erlangen, where he received his degree as a doctor of medicine. And what's interesting is he basically did this with his own attainments. He really didn't spend much time in medical school, but he was such a genius and had done such an extensive amount of reading that he was awarded a medical degree on August 10th, 1779. He basically had to defend his dissertation at the time, and he received his degree. Shortly afterwards, he had a desire to stay in Germany. He moved to this town called Hettstadt, which was essentially a small copper mining town, about 3,000 to 4,000 inhabitants. It did afford him the opportunity to continue his love and study of chemistry, which occupied many of his days of leisure. He was able to fill in certain gaps in his understanding of mining science and metallurgy. But it wasn't really a place where he could be really find a profitable occupation to support him, and really not the type of social intercourse that an individual of this brilliance really required. So it really couldn't help him to advance his intellectual development. So after 9 months in Hettstedt, he packed up his belongings, and in the spring of 1781, he moved to Dessau. And one of the big consolations here is he was able to visit the local apothecary, where he could basically continue his study of chemistry. And this is just 50 kilometers from Hettstedt. But it was a very attractive ducal town, that had a very active intellectual life, so a better place for him to be. And you can see, again, right on the Elbe River, all these places that he'll visit is just basically in the same part of modern-day Germany. And this is where basically he meets his first wife, Johanna. He's there busily occupied with chemistry, and this brings him to contact with what's called Hassler's Pharmacy, and there he becomes acquainted with the stepdaughter of the pharmacist, a woman by the name of Johanna Henriette Kutschler. And at this point, Hahnemann writes, "There I began to enjoy for the first time the innocent joys of home life, together with the amenities of business and the companionship of my life partner, Henriette Kutschler, stepdaughter of the apothecary Hassler of Dessau." You can see here he had a total of 11 children, unfortunately many of them experienced quite a bit of tragedy. Two of them were actually murdered, and we'll see this a little bit later on. But you can see here, you can read about all of his children later, and we'll spend some interesting time talking about Friedrich, who was a homeopath in his own right and a very interesting person, an incredible story, really. Because he really couldn't make a living in Dessau, he then moved to Gamern in 1781, and he accepted the post of medical officer. This is a town right near Magdeburg. And then he only stayed there for a short period of time, in about 3 years. In 1784, he and his wife Johanna moved to Dresden. Dresden was the capital city of the Free State of Saxony in Germany. It's situated in a valley on the River Elbe, right near the Czech border. Has a very long history as the capital, with lots of cultural and artistic splendors. It's called the Jewel Box because of its Baroque and Rococo city center, and it's one of the cultural and educational, political and economic centers really of Germany and Europe. Now, while he was in Dresden, he did some very important work. First of all, there's the possibility that he actually met Antoine Lavoisier. Maybe he met him, maybe he didn't, but certainly he was working on chemistry, and he had the opportunity to go and see him at a talk that Lavoisier was giving, and this demonstrated, again, his incredible respect for Lavoisier and also his desire to learn more about chemistry. He also, at this period of time, translates the story of Abelard and Heloise from English into German. And this demonstrates his incredible knowledge, not just of science and medicine, but also of classical literature, that he would know about Abelard, you know, this 12th century, 13th century great writer and thinker, demonstrates incredible level of knowledge. He was also incredibly prodigious. He publishes 2,200 pages of essays and translations during this particular period of time. And in 1784, he basically completely gives up his practice, saying that the medical procedures of his day did his patients more harm than good. And he actually writes, "My sense of duty would not easily allow me to treat the unknown pathological state of my suffering brethren with these unknown medicines," because you didn't know anything about them until he'd actually introduced the idea of proving them, conducting an experiment with them. You don't really know anything about them. It's just guesswork. "The thought of becoming in this way a murderer or malefactor towards the life of my fellow human beings was most terrible to me, so terrible and disturbing that I wholly gave up my practice in the first years of my married life and occupied myself solely with chemistry and writing." So you can see the integrity and morality of this man, that he's not going to practice medicine because he sees that it does more harm than good. Also in 1784, he finishes his first large-scale work called Directions for Curing Radically Old Sores and Indolent Ulcers, and it's published in Leipzig, and it contains many useful observations on the management of old ulcers. And even in this very early effort, you can see his disgust for the absurd modes of treating disease that were common in his day. And he illustrates this with many examples from his own practice when he was in Hermannstadt in Transylvania. And then in 1785, he translates Domaki's The Wholesale Manufacture of Chemicals from German from French into German. And in this work, he completely demonstrates his complete mastery of French. Because this is a very complex book. It's written that if ever a work was worth translating, it is certainly the present one. This is from a book called Krell's Annals. And it's written, "If ever a work was worth translating, it is certainly the present one, which, fortunately for all its readers, fell into the hands of one who has made it more complete. Domaki's original French work has always been appreciated by all readers who knew this language. Dr. Hahnemann has rendered it into German, making many detailed corrections and additions. We have now, therefore, reason to assert that there does not exist a better work on the manufacture of chemical products than the present one." And you have to understand that basically Hahnemann was self-taught in chemistry. And he makes all these incredible suggestions on technical matters, like, you know, instructions on how to copper plate engravers, the builders, the different types of devices to use. So it just shows what incredible genius Hahnemann was, that he could not only translate the work from one language to another, but that he could make corrections on very, very detailed and technical matters. Now, because Hahnemann refused to practice medicine and wouldn't go along with authority and consensus, he had to move a tremendous amount. And he was so thoroughly disgusted with medicine that basically, he had to live off of his translations. And so in 12 years between 1792 and 1804, he lived in 14 different towns. And between 1777 and 1806, he translated 24 large textbooks and numerous articles into German, usually accompanied with extensive footnotes and detailed corrections of his own. And Gumpert, in his biography of Hahnemann, wrote that Hahnemann sat at his desk writing until his fingers were sore. There was no more talk of medical practice. The doctor was a fanatic devotee of the quill pen, who now drowned his sorrows over his lost medical career in a sea of ink. And in 1787, he has his work on arsenic poisoning. Again, you can see his disillusionment with the medical practice of this time. He writes, "A number of causes, which I will not recount here, have for several centuries reduced the dignity of that godlike science, practical medicine, to a wretched breadwinning." And look at that asterisk there, wretched breadwinning. "A glossing over of symptoms, a degrading commerce in prescriptions. God help us, to a trade that mixes the disciples of Hippocrates with the riffraff and medical rogues in such a way that one is indistinguishable from the other. How rarely does an honest man occasionally succeed in raising himself by exceptional knowledge and talents above this swarm of quacks." And so you can see he was just intolerant of people who were willing to compromise for the sake of making a living and would not be willing to do what is right. And you can see here the word breadwinning, and I wanted to contrast this with a wonderful quote from a talk that Friedrich Schiller gave at the University of Jena. He was invited to be a lecturer there, and at his very first lecture, he gave a talk on universal history. And in that he wrote, "New discoveries in the sphere of his activities, which cast the bread-fed scholar down," the person who only is concerned about something because he wants to make a living, he says, "new discoveries in the sphere of his activities, which cast the bread-fed scholar down, delight the philosophical mind. Perhaps they fill a gap which had still disfigured the growing whole of his conceptions. Or they set the stone still missing in the edifice of his ideas, which then completes it. Even should these new discoveries leave it in ruins, a new chain of thoughts, a new natural phenomenon, a newly discovered law in the material world overthrow the entire edifice of a science, no matter. He has always loved truth more than his system, and he will gladly exchange the old, insufficient form for a new one, more beautiful." And with those very beautiful words, I would like to complete the first session of this 11-session series, because this really, I think, really is the essence of the mindset of somebody who really wants to practice homeopathy. This idea that we are always aspiring to this greater truth, that this greater beauty, whereupon we can act for the benefit of all beings, that we can work to improve the lot of life of others. And you can see that Hahnemann and Schiller embrace this exact same sentiment. So we'll continue. We didn't have the opportunity to do any of Hahnemann's cases, but again, please review the cases. They're both up on the web page on the Whole Health Now website and also in the whncourses.com site. Review these cases because we will be discussing these cases. I have to present them in their historical time frame. So the first one will come out around 1797, and then we'll be looking at some cases in the early 1800s, and then some of the Hahnemann's cases in the later 1800s. And we'll be doing this for all of the important homeopathic figures from our great history. So I want to wish, again, everybody a very good evening, and I hope that this was useful to you. And if you would like to sign up for the course, please feel free to go to the Whole Health Now website and register for the course. I wish everybody a very good evening, and thank you again for your attention.